This morning, I want us to focus on the treasures of our hearts, especially after we're dead and gone. Will we leave behind anything more than an empty pew? Will we leave a lasting legacy that benefits others and this church's future generations?
Sacred hour of worship, when we name things for what they really are.
We give God.
What is God?
Between the demands of this last week and the demands of the one ahead.
We give to God. What is God?
With open hearts and hands and minds, every innate gift from our loving Creator.
We give to God. What is God?
Please Christ as your everyone, join me in singing hymn 301, all are welcome.
Thank you.
Sins. So let us confess with courage and hope.
We confess that we are a forgetful people. We hear the stories of your greatness and goodness, but we fail to live in a way that shows their power and promise. We spend our time and energy chasing earthly rewards. We disregard the fact that yours is the only legacy that matters. Burn the lessons of your faithfulness on our hearts, O God, and help us to be living legacies of your love. Amen.
Please join me in the appeals of heart. I'll give you one, and we'll give you all. Friends, believe the gracious good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to pass on the time with the kids today and invite you to turn in your hymn book, if you need to number 455, listen to the word that God has spoken. We'll sing it through two times as our song of illumination this morning. Concerning treasures. Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Yes.
Thank you, Bill. Please join me in a prayer. Draw near to us, O God. Speak to us of eternal things. Surprise us with your grace and good news, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, may it all be acceptable to you, O God, who is our strength and our Savior. Amen. In his book, Who Switched the Price Tags, Dr. Tony Campolo mentions a survey of 50 people over the age of 95 who were asked one question. If you had to live your life over again, what would you do differently? Most responses fell into one of three categories. One, reflect more. People said they would stop and ponder things they had taken for granted. They would live more in the moment and stop and smell the roses. Two, risk more. People said they would take more risks instead of living a safe and calculated life. They would break out of the security of their routines and seek new adventures. Three, leave a legacy. People said that they wanted to do more things that would live on after they died. They wanted to do a better job of leaving a lasting impact. Since I retired 2 years ago, I've been reflecting on my own legacy. What am I leaving behind? What will family members and friends say about me at my memorial service? What words will be etched on the gravestone up at the cemetery for me? How will the treasures of my heart make a difference in this church's future ministry and mission? Osceola McCarty used her heart's treasure to leave a legacy. She was an African-American woman from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. She left school after the sixth grade to take care of a sick relative and then went to work as a washerwoman. For 75 years, she washed, ironed, and folded the laundry of wealthy families of bankers, lawyers, and doctors in her town. She earned just pennies, but managed to put away whatever she could and eventually started a small savings account at the bank. Osceola lived a simple life. Her treasures on earth were few. She lived in a modest frame house near the campus of the University of Southern Mississippi. She never owned a car. She walked a mile to and from the grocery store every week. And on Sundays, she went to the Friendship Baptist Church with her Bible in hand, held together with Scotch tape. When she was 87, with hands gnarled by arthritis, McCarty had to retire. So she began to put her affairs in order and decide what she wanted to do with the little that she had accumulated. In 1995, the development office of the University of Southern Mississippi received a phone call from the bank. They had a check for the school from Osceola McCarty, a check for $150,000. No one at the college had ever heard of this woman. She had never set foot on the campus. This washerwoman, who had never been to high school, let alone college, gave away virtually everything she had made in order to start a minority student scholarship at the school. The gift at the time made front page news, and in an interview before she died, she was asked why she didn't spend the money she had earned on herself. Osceola smiled and said, and spending it on herself. Reflecting on her comment, a Presbyterian pastor said,
I don't know exactly what Jesus had in mind when he said we should store up for ourselves treasure in heaven, but I suspect O.C.O. McCartney knew what he meant. What do you treasure, friends? What do you value? What legacy will you leave? Show me your treasure, Jesus says, and I will show you your heart. Presbyterian author and preaching professor Tom Long says, what our heart really desires, of course, is to count. To count for something and to count to someone. To come to the end of the day or the end of a life with the satisfaction of having stood for what is good, with the joy of having been loved and having love in return, and with the peace of having walked with God. These are the true treasures, the treasures of God's kingdom, a fortune that no thief can plunder. Friends, each of us has to decide, what do we want to do with our heart's treasure? Each of us is leaving a legacy in this life. The question is, what kind? Yeah. Usually, I think we look at a legacy as a bequest of money or property given to family and offspring or to an institution through a will. During my time as your pastor, this church was blessed with two such legacies. In 2014, we received a bequest from Bill Turner's will. Bill had been a member and a church officer here 40 years ago. Bill and his wife moved here so he could be superintendent of the schools, and he had been raised and attended the Baptist church all of his life. But when he attended the local church here, he didn't feel at home. So he and his wife decided to come visit our church. And guess what? They got converted. The Turners were heavily invested in this community and in this congregation. They raised money for and worked on this sanctuary with their own hands when this space was built. And Bill, along with Emma Cart, are the ones who made our famous crooked cross from a tree that was cut down on the property when this sanctuary was built. Eventually, Bill and his wife retired and moved to Ruidoso. The former Baptist was known as Mr. Presbyterian at First Church there. Bill left his church a $10,000 legacy gift, and it came at a very crucial time in our church history and helped us financially over 3 years. Then, between 2017, that would be way back, and 2019, Ed and Betty Brown left us three different bequests. Betty and Ed had a home in Horseshoe Springs and were very close friends with Dick and D.H. Ford. Ed had been wounded in World War II. The doctors didn't think he would live for more than 5 years. When he came home to recuperate, he and Betty got married, and they were together for 59 years. They moved to Albuquerque after the war, adopted and raised two sons, and became very involved at First Presbyterian there. Then in their retirement, they started spending a lot more time up here in the Hamas, and they got involved in this church. Ed served as an elder and the clerk of session. Betty served as a deacon, and she was known for her knitted animals that she gave as gifts. Ed was wheelchair bound because of that war injury, but it didn't slow him down. And I am convinced that he is the reason our facility is so handicapped accessible. The Browns left us almost $44,000 in their legacy gift. And over the years, it has helped us pay for new hymnals, to support Beverly in the music program, to start a youth group with a youth director a couple of years ago, and other expenses related to music and education. You see, a legacy is a gift for the future. It's something tangible that we can leave that will impact the people that come after us. Earlier this year, I volunteered to serve on our church's new Forward in Faith team, along with Diane, Barb Allen, and Shannon. We're planning to raise new funds to ensure this church's financial future. You see, when I started here over 20 years ago, we had $110,000 in the bank. No doubt, a lot of legacy gifts from previous generations. And the money accumulated over the years when this church was served by guest preachers and temporary pastoral relationships. Then in 2002, you called and installed me as your pastor, the first one in over 100 years. The church's $110,000 legacy funds were used over the past 20 years to pay for our ministry and our mission expenses that exceeded what we brought in, including me, your pastor. I guesstimate right now there's probably about $20,000 left of those original funds, plus the other legacies we've received. And what we want to do is raise new funds to ensure that our church continues to have a pastor and make a lasting impact in this community in the years ahead. So we're going to launch a Forward in Faith campaign as part of our 145th anniversary next year. Right now, we have a little over $1,450 already started to fund. We want to do more than $14,500. We want to dream and try to raise $145,000 over 3 years. And it won't come just from the folks sitting in the pews. We hope that we can reach out to everyone and anyone who has had a relationship with this church and loves this church and cares for this community as much as we do. More information will be coming in the near future. So I invite you to start praying about how you can leave a legacy like Bill Turner and Betty and Ed Brown. Now, even though I've been talking about the financial aspect of leaving a legacy, I want you to know that it is more than just about money. It's about what we treasure, what we value, where we put our hearts, and how we invest ourselves. You see, no matter our age or income or situation in life, each of us is creating a legacy in what we do and what we say and who we help and in where we invest ourselves. What kind of legacy are you leaving behind? One of my favorite movies is back from 1995, Mr. Holland's Opus. You may remember it. It's about a frustrated composer in Portland, Oregon, who takes a job as a high school band teacher back in the 1960s. Glenn Holland, played by Richard Dreyfuss, believes his school job is only temporary because his lifelong goal is to achieve critical fame and success as a classical musician. Mr. Holland is determined to write an opus and composes at his piano after putting in a full day at school. But his family demands increase after they discover that their son is deaf. And the pressures at work and family keep multiplying. And Mr. Holland realizes that his dream of leaving a lasting musical legacy is probably wishful thinking. At the end of the movie, we find an older Mr. Holland fighting in vain to keep funding for the arts at the high school and to keep his job. The school board decides to reduce the budget by cutting the music and art and drama program. No longer a reluctant band teacher, Mr. Holland believes in what he does, and he passionately defends the role of art in public education. What began as a career detour became a 35-year mission where he poured his heart into the lives of young people each and every year. After school ends for the summer, Mr. Holland returns to the classroom to retrieve his belongings. With regret and sorrow on his face, he fills up his box with treasures from being a teacher. His wife and son arrive to give him a hand. As they leave the room and start walking down the hall to go out to the car, Mr. Holland hears some noise in the auditorium. School's over, vacation has started. He wonders what's going on, so he opens the door to the auditorium to see what's happening, and he's surprised to see it full of former students, teaching colleagues, and this big banner across the stage that says, "Goodbye, Mr. Holland." They greet him with a standing ovation while present and past students play tunes they learned from his hand. His wife, who is in on the surprise, approaches the podium and engages in small talk until the master of ceremonies arrives. It's the governor of Oregon. The governor is a former student. Mr. Holland helped to believe in herself his first year of teaching. She addresses the crowd of well-wishers and speaks for the hundreds when she said, "Mr. Holland had a profound influence in my life and on a lot of lives. Yet I get the feeling he considers a great part of his life misspent. Rumor has it he was always working on his symphony and that was going to make him rich and famous. But Mr. Holland isn't rich, and he's not famous, at least outside our town. So it might be easy for him to think himself a failure, but he's wrong, because I think he achieved a success far beyond riches and fame." Looking at Mr. Holland on the front row, the governor gestures to the rest of the people that are there and says, "Look around you, Mr. Holland. There is not a life in this room that you have not touched. And each of us is a better person because of you. We are your symphony, Mr. Holland. We are the melodies and notes of your opus. We are the music of your life. Show me your treasure," Jesus says, "and I will show you your heart." We're all going to leave a legacy. What kind of legacy are you going to leave? Thanks be to God. Amen. The choir is going to share a song with us now.
I haven't practiced. Are you sure?
Thank you.
Morning. So we're going to sing that song together for our doxology. So if you want to get a hymn book out while we're getting ready for the offering, it's number 710 in the hymn book, and we'll sing that in just a minute. We sing "We Are an Offering" because God has blessed us in so many ways in this world, and it is right and it's fitting and it's proper for us to return thanks for the blessings that we have received from God. So I invite you to do that at this time, to make offerings of your life and your labor and your love.
Thank you.
invite you to join me in our units of prayer of dedication, words are in your bulletin. And this prayer is adapted from a hymn titled, When Giving Your Gifts. Let us pray together. O Lord, you said,
don't store up those treasures of earth, for kept on their shelves, they lose what they're worth. The moth will consume them, the rust will destroy, and thieves will take all that you hope to enjoy. O Lord, you said, seek treasures above, like sharing of bread and labors of love. Like kindness to strangers and gifts to the poor, these gifts given humbly will surely endure. O Lord, help us to always to seek and share your treasures with those in need. Amen.
I invite you to join together now as God's people and to lift up your prayers this week. I invite you to share whatever prayers of joy or concern you have with one another. Let's share the first one.
Little art piece on the table behind David. Where by Israel, and it says shalom, salam, and peace. And certainly that's a prayer to be lifted up now, and given what's going on in Israel, Gaza. We honor our joy and peace be.
Peace.
Lord, hear our prayer. David, we have a prayer from Suzanne Swetnam for her nephew, Chris, who is still at stage 4 cancer. He did receive good news last week. His tumors have shrunk by 20% with a protein therapy. May they continue to shrink. This is his last hope.
Lord,
hear our prayers.
Also for Elizabeth, who's going through another brain surgery.
Lord,
hear our prayers. That's Elizabeth Breslow, right? Do you know how to reach where she is?
Yeah. Okay. For Caleb and Ryan Coward, they've been struggling with infertility. That's the good news that they're expecting. So let's pray for healthy pregnancy.
For here are others.
For the 6 adults and their 1 child in the church's food pantry yesterday.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For Christy, who organized this sale we had, it was very successful yesterday.
Amen.
And worked very hard on her.
How much? $656 so far, and there's still more things to be sold. So we give thanks and praise God.
Lord, hear our prayers. David, I'd like to pray for all the folks who are healing from hip replacements and other surgeries. Right now, we've got Susan Dollinger, Ruth Marcanti, Alice, and who?
Diana Sellers.
Diana Sellers. Yeah, that's the one I was trying to come up to the top of my mind.
Right. Healing prayers for all of them.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Healing prayers for Rick Walters, Robert Patterson, Diana Fellers, and Mark Summers, all dealing with cancer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Prayers of comfort and rest and peace for your pastor, the Cockellers. Thanks for taking this week off too, and good for being the vacation and your studying. I can't remember it, but I hope she has a restful period of time away and comes back re-energized in the mood to serve you in this community. Or
for you and your ministry in this pit,
Thank you.
Lord,
hear our prayer.
Any other? Well, let's join together and sing.
Are we gonna say the Lord's Prayer?
Oh, in a minute.
Okay. So what were you doing?
We're singing.
Okay. Okay, got it.
All these prayers in Christ's name, who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us out of temptation, and deliver us into heaven. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The bride should stand in body or spirit as you are able and sing our closing hymn number 716. God is giving, knows no end. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.